Hi. We took some time off and spent a little over 2 weeks down in Florida. And we actually filmed some of the highlights of that trip and posted them in our last video. If you're interested, you might want to take a look at it. But I'll give you a warning. It's not our typical high-tech scientific type of video. It just gives us an opportunity to share some of the things that we did and some of the fun that we had while we were down there. And for those of you who are questioning it, no, it was not a tax-deductible trip. Now, we've had a lot of questions over the years about how we come up with the ideas for our videos. Most of them are just based on things that I've always been fascinated by or my sons find interesting. A few of them originate from viewers' comments below other videos, and a few are derivative. When we come up with the idea for a video, we do a little bit of research, and then we make a decision. Is it a subject that will be generally interesting to people? Is it something that we can physically accomplish? Or is it something that may be too sensitive? For example, we've held on to a couple of videos on advancements in CRISPR technology because of the recent global human malware event over the last couple of years. But if it passes those tests, then we deep dive into the research, do the engineering, build the project, and make the video. And in that process, we often touch on related topics that themselves are kind of interesting, but they're just too tangential to the main video to include with those videos. This is one of those derivative videos. A couple of years ago, I did a series on epoxy, how it works, how to work with it, how to modify it. And one thing you discover whenever you're working with a resin system, it can be epoxy, urethane, silicone, and you have to add a hardener or a catalyst into the resin to get it to cure. As you stir it, you will inevitably introduce air, bubbles, which turns a previously clear liquid kind of milky. That's not so good if you're doing a clear coat. It can have a small negative effect on the properties of the resin. And if the bubbles are large enough near the surface as it cures, it can leave craters behind. Not good. A simple way to deal with that is to take the mixed resin compound, place it inside of a vacuum chamber, and apply a modest level of vacuum for a couple of minutes. Because the bubbles start out at atmospheric pressure, when you remove the surrounding atmosphere, they enlarge a lot. And the force that's pushing them up through the liquid, the buoyancy, is related to the cube of their diameter, their volume. But the flow or the resistance to movement is related to the square of the diameter, the surface area. So large bubbles will move much more quickly to the surface and rupture than tiny bubbles, just like large bubbles in a glass of seltzer versus the tiny bubbles in a pint of Guinness. Once the bubbles have ruptured, you reintroduce the air and you've recovered your previously clear resin. It works. Vacuum chambers are also kind of useful if you're infusing wood with resins to strengthen them or preservatives. Wood contains a lot of air. That's why it's so light. If you place the liquid inside the chamber, put the wood into the liquid, and then apply a vacuum, those liquids will diffuse much more quickly into the wood through capillary action if they're not blocked by trapped air bubbles. Because these techniques are so useful and relatively common, you can go online, like Amazon, and pick up a kit for between $100 and $200 for this purpose. And a lot of them even come with sketchy little vacuum pumps that are perfectly adequate for that purpose. In a more recent video we did on making graphene yourself at home, if you're interested, take a look. I think it's a pretty good video. Bottom line is I needed a vacuum chamber, so I hooked up one of these chambers to a much better quality pump, a two-stage mechanical pump from Yellow Jacket that's pretty popular with HVAC technicians. And when I tested it, I found that I was able to pull the chamber down to about a 1/12,000th of an atmosphere in a cook pot. So I didn't need that much vacuum for the video, but it got me thinking, you know, how low could you go? So I've decided to test that. Now, a lot of these kits will be supplied with a small hole in the side of the chamber in order to be able to hook up vacuum lines or vacuum gauges and purge valves. So I took a step drill and drilled out this hole to 18 millimeters in diameter. And then I welded on the side of the pot a short length of stainless steel tubing that simply provides a much better flow path for the gas to be able to get out of the chamber and into the vacuum pump. I then decided to add another stage to the pumping and hooked up a small diffusion pump. And if you're wondering, yes, I've got diffusion pumps laying around, but I also have turbomolecular pumps laying around. And the reason I picked the diffusion pump is because you can pick up a small pump like the one I have here for less than $200 on eBay or surplus sites. And unlike the turbomolecular pumps with their electronic controllers, high-speed motors, super tight tolerances, there are no moving mechanical parts in a diffusion pump. So no matter how used it is, it's still pretty likely to work, unless of course it's got a bullet hole in the side of it. Now the way that it works is kind of interesting. In the bottom of the chamber is a small reservoir that contains a specialized fluid. In the past, they would often use mineral oil or even mercury. Nowadays, it's almost always going to be a synthetic silicone-based diffusion pump fluid that has a very high thermal degradation temperature and at room temperature has an extremely low vapor pressure. If I left this thing open, it would never evaporate. There's no aroma to it. Underneath the reservoir is a small heating element. When the heater warms this fluid, the vapor pressure increases and the vapor begins to rise through the larger of the two pipes on the pump. It's guided through the center of that pipe by a small diameter tube or chimney. And at the top is a conical deflector like this. And there can be one, two, three stages of these. What happens is as the vapor reaches the deflector, it's redirected downward and outward. And when it reaches the cool outer sides of the pump, which in some cases is air-cooled, in our case, water-cooled, the vapor will condense back into a liquid and drip back into the reservoir to continue the cycle indefinitely. Because of the heat, the molecules of the diffusion pump fluid are actually traveling highly supersonically. So if a gas molecule drifts into the pump and gets into that flow path of the vapor, it's driven downward toward the bottom of the pump, where the fore pump or the primary pump will remove it from the system. The net result is a pressure differential between the top and the bottom of the pump that can exceed 1,000,000 to 1. It's pretty impressive. Now, one caveat, it won't work at atmospheric pressure. There are just too many air molecules for the fluid to keep up. But once you bring the pressure down to about 1/1000th of an atmosphere, and the lower the better, it begins to work. Another little caveat is that even though you might be able to pick up a small pump like this for less than $200, you may spend as much for the fluid. This stuff's expensive. But it lasts almost indefinitely, and a small pump like the one we have here only requires 30 milliliters. So a bottle like this would be enough to fuel a pretty large pump, although they do get really big. The very largest ones made won't fit in this room. I then added one more stage to the pumping, a cold trap. Now the way these work are pretty interesting. The gas leaves the chamber, goes down to the bottom of this volume here, makes a 180 degree turn, and comes back up into the diffusion pumps. The idea is that if you put this part of the trap in a cold bath, it can be ice water, dry ice, liquid nitrogen, like we're going to be using. Anything that condenses or freezes at the temperature of the bath is trapped inside of here. That helps to protect the pumps downstream from contamination. It can remove volatile oils, solvents, water vapor, carbon dioxide, and at liquid nitrogen temperatures, even oxygen. And because it's removing a lot of material before it ever makes its way to the pumps, it also improves the pumping speed. Now, you can use these in either direction, in or out, either port. But if you think you're going to build up a lot of condensate, you don't want to be drawing the vacuum out through that center pipe, because with pressure changes, you could potentially siphon the material into the pump. But if you're not producing much, it doesn't really matter. Now, I hooked up everything as you see it here and ran the system for about 45 minutes. And I was able to peg the meter down at 1 micron, or basically a millionth of an atmosphere, in a cook pot with a glass lid and a rubber gasket. I was really impressed. So I invited my wife out here and I said, "What do you think?" And she was like, wow, that's really neat. That's fantastic. And then she asked the devastating question, "So, what are you going to do with it?" I hate that because I was kind of like, well, I don't know. I mean, I built it and it works. It's really cool. And she's like, "Yes, dear. But what are you going to do with it?" Now, she knows me. She gets it. But it did get me thinking. It's like, what am I going to do with it? And what occurred is that because this is sort of vacuum at a budget, I might be willing to do things with this or to this that I wouldn't be willing to do to a high-end vacuum system with its expensive pumps and valves and motors. And so what would happen if I was to expose a bunch of common materials for a prolonged period at vacuum? What happens to them? Ran that past my son and he was like, "Yeah, actually that sounds kind of interesting. It's like what happens to stuff in deep space or orbit?" And that's when the light bulb went off. Now, before you Kerbal people start typing like crazy, I know that a millionth of an atmosphere is still a billion times higher pressure than you will get in deep space. But for the purposes of testing these materials, it's effectively equivalent. 99.9999% of being in deep space is going to be present at those kind of pressures in the chamber. Because what the atmosphere does is it acts as an enormous heat sink. If you're warmer than the surrounding air, it cools you off. If you're cooler, it warms you up. It also provides an equilibration of water vapor so that we don't just desiccate. And it blocks radiation. A number of infrared wavelengths that come from the sun can't get through our atmosphere. And most of the short wavelength UV is blocked as well. So if we're going to simulate the effect of being in orbit, we also have to simulate the effect of the sun. And in keeping with the idea of high vacuum, low budget, I decided to hack a metal halide bulb. Literally. Let me show you one way to do it. This is a metal halide bulb. They're slowly being supplanted by LEDs because of the increased efficiency of the LEDs. They run cooler, they last longer. But because of the huge installed infrastructure of HID and metal halide lighting, they still make these, and they're quite inexpensive. The way they work is inside this outer jacket is a small envelope, usually made out of fused quartz, or if they call it a ceramic bulb, aluminum oxide. Inside that envelope is a buffer gas, typically argon, and a variety of metals and metal salts, including mercury. What happens is when an arc is struck, the gases heat up, the metals evaporate, and they start producing electromagnetic radiation in a variety of discrete emission bands typical of each of the metals. The manufacturer can design, based on their choice of the metals that are added, what kind of generalized hue you get from the bulb when you add up the average of all those different emission bands. That's why when you look on the outside of a box for one of these bulbs, it'll often say 2700K or 5000 Kelvin. That isn't the temperature of the envelope. It is the closest approximation that averaging of all those individual emission bands has to an actual physical object at that thermal temperature, like the sun is at 5700 Kelvin. Another thing you'll see on the outside of the box is a symbol that says either UB or universal burn. That means that the bulbs can either burn in any kind of orientation, or the fact that they have to be normally burned inverted like this as they would be in, say, high bay lighting fixture. Look for the UB or universal burn symbol. It just gives you a little bit more flexibility. Now, calculating the amount of power we need out of the bulb is quite easy. The sun dumps about 1.3 kilowatts over every square meter of area above our atmosphere, or 130 milliwatts per square centimeter. The inside of our test chamber is almost exactly 3,000 square centimeters. So we need 400 watts. But because the inside of the chamber is reflective, it's made out of stainless steel, it's a poor reflector at about 50%. But it means that any of the light that doesn't hit our samples and hits the wall is going to re-enter the chamber, or 50% of it will. If it misses again, 25%, and then 12, 6, 3. when you add up all of those retroreflections, the intensity on the samples is approximately double what it would be if we took the samples at the same distance from the lamp, but we had it in open space. So we actually need a 200 watt bulb like this. What's interesting is a metal halide bulb is 100% efficient, really. Unless it's heating up or it's cooling down, all of the current that is consumed by the bulb is turned into electromagnetic radiation. Only about 16 to 18% of it is in the visible spectrum. So we say its luminous efficiency is 16 to 18%. Most of the light is in the infrared and in the ultraviolet. We're going to want that light though, because the sun produces that kind of light. Now the reason for the jacket is protective. Obviously this looks pretty delicate inside. You don't want to touch it. It's also running at high temperature and high voltage. Again, you don't want to touch it. And if the oils in your skin, the acidity in the oil in your skin gets on that quartz, when it gets up to temperature, it can devitrify. Again, you don't want to touch it. But the envelope also blocks radiation. It blocks a number of infrared wavelengths and almost all of the UV below 400 nanometers, so we don't get sunburn or skin cancer or ozone generation. So we've got to remove that jacket. Now, the first thing you're going to need to do is you're going to need to do this in a controlled fashion, because the inside of some of these bulbs, and you don't know which ones, are at a reduced pressure. They do that in order to provide some insulation so that inner jacket, that quartz envelope, gets hotter to vaporize the metals. Because they don't tell you which ones, we should always assume that it's at a partial vacuum. So if we were to hit this with a hammer, it would implode and probably damage the inside structure. So we have to do it in a controlled fashion. The first thing is, find a socket that you can put this in, because you're not going to want to freehand this operation. You want something you can bolt down to a base, or something that you can put into a vise. And when you put it in the socket, don't crank down on it real hard, because when you remove the jacket, it's going to be harder to get it out. So you just want to tighten this in enough that it doesn't wiggle. And make sure you have the right kind of socket. These come in all different shapes and sizes. There are linear tubes that have electrodes at both ends. Probably not a good choice in a small chamber. I like the screw bases better. But even those screw bases come in different sizes. They have what's called a mogul base, which is a large screw base, usually for the higher power bulbs, and then what they call a medium size base, which is typical of a normal light bulb. This is a medium size base. Now, the first step, as you can see here, is you want to start putting some tape around here. I like using the duct tape instead of using electrical tape, simply because the reinforcement fibers make it a little bit more robust. Once you've put a layer of the tape up, then stop for a second and mark where you're going to be willing, and I'll do it on the other side too, where you're going to be willing to cut into the bulb so that you don't damage the inside structure. Because once you fully wrap up the bulb to protect it, you won't be able to see what's inside. So then you can continue your line up like this, and you'll know where it's safe to cut it. Now, the first thing that we're going to want to do is we're going to want to equalize the pressure inside the bulb, and we're going to cut into the bottom of the bulb where the glass is thickest, so it's least likely to fracture. So we're going to set this up here on the vise, and then I'm going to put on a little safety equipment. And I like using a Dremel with a large cutoff wheel. It's a nice tool for doing this operation. But this will be a little bit loud for you headphone users, so be prepared. One, two, three. All right, now we've penetrated inside, so we've equalized the pressure. Now the next thing that you've got to look at is on the top of these bulbs, they have a little dimple, and that's used to help support this electrode that runs up there so that the thing stays a little bit more stout when you handle it or you move it around. Because this is attached to the inside, if the glass comes away a little bit unevenly, it could bend the inner structure. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to free up the top. We're going to decapitate the bulb. So we're going to turn this guy around like this. And we're going to start cutting. Loud again. Now, once this thing becomes free, sometimes it's easy to do the final free up with a razor blade to save time. You don't necessarily have to do the whole thing with the Dremel tool, but you can, it's up to you. And now we've freed up the inner part of the bulb. Now, the next step is going to be cutting down laterally along here. Turn it over. And now the last step is you're going to want to cut all the way through here, and you might find, in this case, it fractured away, so I got kind of lucky. But this side didn't, so we're not going to have to cut this apart. So I'm going to keep this on just to protect the inside as I cut into this other part of the base. I have yet to find a bulb where the inner structure is smaller than the neck of the bulb, so that you could just cut around the circle and kind of lift it off. If you find one, you're lucky, but I haven't seen one yet. One last cut. We'll see if we can make this Dremel work. Almost ran out of wheel, but it looks like I got there. Now let's see if we can free this thing up here. You can see it makes a bit of a mess, but it's pretty much come across. Probably should use the razor blade, but let's see if I can just peel it away. Pretty good. Now, the last thing you want to do is some of these shards are kind of dangerous. So what I like to do is using the Dremel, we'll see if I can still use the same wheel. Now, watch your camera because this is going to probably spray some debris. That's actually pretty good. Now, I found the best way to store these bulbs when you're done with this, I'm going to put this down here, is literally just keep them in the base. That way you can put them down on a tabletop, and if you want to keep them clean, you can even put the box that they came in on top to protect them. Now, the next thing I'm going to talk about is the socket here. These things come in both ceramic and plastic, and a high UV, high vacuum system, you want to use the ceramic versions. On the bottom of the socket, I soldered two flexible high voltage wires. And then I led them through this rubber stopper. This is just what seals it in the side of the chamber, like this. And then one of the problems with multi-strand wire is that it's nice and flexible, but it isn't vacuum tight, even if the jacket is, because air can actually transmit or transport itself up through the individual fibers in the wire. Now, soldering this will fix that. The problem is you can't solder above the level of the insulation. Now, the other problem is if you try to, say, just put this on a regular socket like this XT90 that I've got right here, almost every kind of electrical socket is just press fit. It is not vacuum tight. So if you just welded this on here and then tried to somehow, or soldered it on, and tried to seal it, you'd end up with a huge glob of adhesive and RTV trying to make this work. Simplest thing is just bust this apart, take out the leads, and solder them individually on the ends of the wire. Then take some flexible tubing, this nice, soft, 35 durometer silicone rubber tubing. I get it from McMaster Car. Cut a couple of segments of this, place a little Vaseline or vacuum grease over it so it slides, and slide these things up, and you got a nice vacuum tight seal. And don't forget, mark the polarity of your wires, because once you remove the socket, you don't have any kind of polarity indicator or protection. So make sure that you mark them so that when you plug this into the receptacle, you're not going to get a dysfunctional bulb. So that's it. Now, let me show you what we decided to test. So these are the samples we selected. And I know we're going to get a lot of comments from people who say, oh, you should have tested fill in the blank. Put it in the comments section. As I've always said, I read all the comments. And if we get some really good suggestions, we can always revisit this because we have the setup. Just like we're going to revisit the cloud chamber or our radiation detector when we test some tobacco products. I think you're going to like that. Here's what I picked. I wanted some latex rubber, so I picked a rubber balloon and some rubber bands. I also chose a piece of aluminized mylar or polyester film. We'll see if the aluminum has any kind of protective value. This is a 4 mil, I can show you here, I'll just move it a little bit, a 4 mil piece of polyethylene film. It's the same thing they construct high altitude balloons out of, which are exposed to a fair amount of UV light, although at a lower temperature. I also have a piece of parsley, a slice of potato. I also have 3 pieces of wood. This is plywood, white oak, and pine or fir. I have a piece of pork, a piece of beef, and despite asking very nicely, nobody was willing to donate any skin. So last night my son made some curried chicken and I took some of the skin, put it out here to duplicate the effect on human skin. And then I also included an old cell phone. It works perfectly fine, and we're going to see whether or not it's immune to the vacuum and the UV, or whether or not it just stops or it blows up. We'll find out what happens. So let's switch this guy on. And go ahead, put this guy in here. And then we're going to go over to the chamber now. Oh, and one other thing I didn't mention, these are duplicates of everything that I'm using here, so we have a control of what happens to this stuff outside of the vacuum chamber. Now, before I slide this in, let me show you something. Inside the chamber, you can see the setup for a light bulb. It's pretty self-explanatory. I also have this piece of aluminum plate that I put here on top of the rubber stopper that connects the pressure gauge just to protect it from the high-intensity UV light inside of the chamber. So we'll go ahead, we'll turn on the pressure gauge, get this rolling, and then I'm going to carefully slip this in, like this. Now, I've got this ring of aluminum that I fashioned with some press fit tabs. I'm going to put this in here, like this, and this has nothing to do with sealing the inside of the chamber. All it does is provides a little bit of light protection or UV protection for the gasket so it doesn't dry out or damage the rubber. Now, what holds this top or plate on is air pressure. So I'm going to turn on the vacuum pump. This is going to be a little bit loud. And then I have to hold this up relatively carefully. Thank you. And we'll get this thing in here like this. Try to center it reasonably well. Like that. And then I'm going to crack the valve and start the vacuum. Now the pressure will hold this up in 5-10 seconds or so. Then I can let go. Good. Now immediately, I want to start putting in some liquid nitrogen, because you don't want to leave the liquid nitrogen in the Dewar before we seal this up, because all it will end up doing is capturing water vapor, carbon dioxide, and oxygen from the air, filling up the cold trap. But we also want to get this in as soon as we can so that we protect our vacuum pumps from the effect of whatever is going to be given off by the samples. So I'll pour this in. Now, a lot of people are nervous about using liquid nitrogen. They think it's dangerous or it's exotic. It's really not. It does have some potential to be dangerous if you have a huge quantity of it and you spill it on the floor in a very sealed room. It could displace the oxygen in the room, but you need a lot and you need a pretty small room. The other thing is, it does have cryogenic properties. It's cold. So the point is, you can freeze yourself, but it's not as bad as you might think. That's called the Leidenfrost effect. Because my skin is so incredibly hot compared to the temperature of the liquid nitrogen, as soon as the liquid nitrogen gets near my skin, it vaporizes and forms a layer of nitrogen gas that insulates me from the liquid. So you don't want to keep your finger in too long, because as your finger cools off, that layer gets thinner and thinner and thinner, and eventually you'll get frostbite. But you got to put a little bit of effort into it. Yes, we'll just keep adding it. Now, if you look at the pressure gauge down here, you'll see the number 1100. That's 1100 microns, or 1.1 millimeters. And that will continue to drop as the pump is doing its thing and the cold trap is doing its thing. And the other thing about liquid nitrogen that's kind of interesting is, a lot of people don't realize it's really cheap. This stuff costs less than $1 a liter and actually has more cooling capacity per dollar than dry ice. So it's pretty good stuff. All right, put the top on this. And now we're simply gonna have to wait a little while, because I need this pressure to bottom out by using just the cold trap and the mechanical pump before we turn on the diffusion pump. So let's give it 5 or 10 minutes. All right, 290 microns. That's about where it seems to be settling. So I'm going to add the diffusion pump now, see if we can get a little bit of additional vacuum and pumping, but I have no fantasy that we're going to get down to 1 micron with all of those contaminants in the system. High vacuum and meat products generally don't go together. So we'll turn on the chiller. Water flows up through there. Then I'm going to plug in the diffusion pump. This will take about 12 minutes or so to warm up to the point that it's able to contribute to the pumping action. So while that's happening, let's go ahead and turn on the lights, or the lamp. Now, if you look inside the chamber when I do this, you'll see some bright flashes. That's the metal beginning to evaporate. That will stabilize in about a minute or so, and then we're going to get continuous output from it. Then I'm also going to turn on the fans here. The reason for the fans is, I don't want to create an oven. We are pouring 200 watts into this chamber, and all I really want to do is test the effect of the radiation from the lamp on the samples. I don't want to try to cook them in a generally warm environment. When I keep the fan on, the outside of this chamber never really rises even to body temperature. Good. Now, The plan is we're going to run this for 24 straight hours, which means every couple of hours, I'm gonna have to come out and I'm gonna have to top off the liquid nitrogen. So it's gonna be a long night. But there's coffee and beer, and I'm not gonna be alone. Let me show you something. We picked up these guys about, 10 days, 11 days ago to add to our coop. And they are eating and drinking and pooping and growing like crazy. And they're really, really cute. So, I'm good. See you tomorrow. For the first 8 hours, everything ran smoothly, and then I noticed at about 4 o'clock in the morning that the cold trap was indeed filling up with condensate. I really had no choice but to introduce air into the system, ease the lid down onto the table, drain the condensate, and reapply the vacuum. The total time was about 10 minutes. Obviously, most of the changes occur early on when the majority of the volatiles are released from the samples. This still continues, but at a slower rate as the vacuum continues to improve all the way to the end of the testing period. Okay. It's been 24 hours and I'm exhausted. It was a long night. And the chickens didn't really appreciate me coming in and out after midnight. But one of the things I wanted to mention to you is that if you look inside there, things look like they've shifted a little bit. And you'll also see that on the time lapse. The reason was, remember the caveat I gave you about how you use a cold trap and the quantity of the condensate? It turns out there was a lot more water vapor as well as whatever came out of the cell phone than I expected. And it actually filled up our cold trap. So at about 4 o'clock in the morning, I had to come back out here and actually drain the cold trap and set everything back up. And that kind of shifted things a little bit with that motion. But it only took me about 5 minutes or so, put the vacuum pump back on. And as you can see, we've been running about 50 microns for the last 8-9 hours. So it's not down to the 1 micron that the empty container was able to maintain. Obviously, there's still some material being given off by the samples, but it's a pretty low pressure. Now, before I flush this with air in order to get the samples out, I've got to cool things off. I got to cool the light and the diffusion pump before we put cold air through them so we don't damage them. So let's turn off the diffusion pump, give this a few minutes to cool, turn off the light, and give that a few minutes to cool, and then we'll take a look at the samples. Okay, this is nice and cool. Diffusion pump is nice and cool. You can see that the pressure came up a little bit. It's kind of waddling around 290, 300, 310, something like that. Turning off the pump hurts the pressure. Turning off the light helps the pressure because we are evaporating less material from the samples. So to get this out, I'm going to turn off the pump. And then I'm going to use my sophisticated purge valve. And you'll see the pressure on the gauge start to go up as I begin to leak the air through here. And then eventually I'm going to have to catch the top. That's it. Okay, let's get this off. Let's take a look at how the shade protected the gasket. Well, it looks pretty good. This works. It might not have been necessary, but it definitely didn't hurt. Wow, okay. That looks pretty funny. And also it smells a little bit. Doesn't smell really nice. Let's see if we can get this out of here. And actually the piece of polyester film or the polyethylene moved over there. Wow. Okay, let's take a look at this. Now, these are the controls, and the wood doesn't actually look that much different. There's a slight change maybe in the color, but it's really pretty hard to detect. The oak definitely is darkened. Or no, maybe it was just the other surface. The oak looks pretty much the same. And the plywood, that definitely did darken. What do they feel like? Ooh, it's far lighter. It feels like styrofoam. I wonder what the surface is like. Does it change it at all? Well, not really. Oh, maybe. Yeah, it's gotten a little bit softer and more friable. Yeah, but it's not that remarkable. Yeah, the wood really hasn't changed except gotten incredibly light. It feels like an aerogel. That's amazing. Yeah, I wish I had brought a scale here to show you, but wow, you can definitely feel the difference. It's much, much lighter. Yeah, all of them are very, very light. Okay, so I guess you could build a spaceship out of oak or pine, or even plywood. It might hold up for a little while, as long as you're not gonna spend too much time in orbit. Now the parsley, oh, that just sort of, okay. So vegetables in space are gonna need a little bit of a light shield. Now the metal-coated mylar, or polyester film, it curled up, probably because of the shrinkage of the plastic versus the metal, but it seems pretty strong. It feels pretty good. This is the control right here. You know, other than the curling, it seems as reflective, doesn't have any kind of burn marks or anything on it. Let's take a look at the latex. Here's the rubber band. Now, is this still stretch? Yeah, well, maybe not. No, definitely we dried out the rubber. This is much tougher. This stuff, yeah, you can feel it. Because it's a little bit weaker. How about the balloon? You're backing up? Yeah, right. I've got my face near it and you're backing up. Yeah, right. Brave soul. Okay. Okay, so the balloon's okay. The potato. Gasp. Looks like a mushroom cap. Wow, this was a potato. All right, I gotta do it, right? I gotta do it. Actually, it tastes like a little bit overdone potato chip. And a little bit of burn to it. Not really good. All right, now, ooh, light. This is the pork. Yeah, this is the old pork, or the non-treated pork. No, that won't do. You don't want to do that. Here's the beef. Same way, it's just like, kind of like an aerogel. Of course, Got to do it, right? You want some?
No.
No. Okay. Oh. Oh. Oh.
Oh, I can smell it.
Oh, it's like eating toilet paper.
Oh.
Oh. Used toilet paper. No. No, no. The chicken skin, not going to eat it. Oh. Wow. Yeah, definitely you want a spacesuit. That's why they spend $1 million on a spacesuit. And if you want a phone home, you're going to need a special kind of phone. Look at what happened to this thing. Split apart. Let's see if I can get the back off this thing. Feels like I can. Oh, the screen is coming across first. Might want to move your camera back a little bit just in case something goes flying when I do this. Looks like the battery pack is actually swollen. That looks like that's what did the swelling of the phone was the battery pack. Yeah, it's crunchy inside. And it's still pretty warm. And you know what I think I'm going to do before we go any further? Is I think I might want to just put this outside. Hang on a sec. So let me just dump that outside just for safety. Oh, that beef is still in my mouth. Oh, man. What I do for science. And then the rest of the phone. Well, I wouldn't expect to see much of a change. Maybe if there were, you know, electrolytic capacitors or surface mount capacitors, you might be able to see some swelling or some drying out. But no, really, it's the battery that's the real problem with this. This might actually be able to function. And I think the damage to the screen was primarily related to whatever was given off by that battery. So, kind of interesting. Definitely not a way to prepare food, maybe the potatoes. And definitely something that you got to take into account, because when you go into space, the lack of an atmosphere, it can do a number of things to common materials that you don't even think about, not only deteriorating surfaces, but for example, lubrication, oils, any kind of solvents, especially like lubricants around bearings and shafts and motors, all of them could potentially dry out or evaporate. We're only talking like 24 hours. If you want a satellite that's going to be able to actuate something after a year, you've got to take into account the potential evaporation of all the solvents and locking up. That's why you have to spend a lot of money when you go into space, not just for the rocket engines, but for the materials and the technology that's going to be located there. So pretty interesting. And like I said before, if you have some other suggestions for things that we may be able to test and that you would like to see us put in the chamber, put it in the comments section. I read them all, and I really appreciate it because it's kind of interesting feedback as well. And if you like the kind of things that we're doing here and the kind of stuff that we're going to be doing in the future, really appreciate it if you take just a second or two and reward us with a subscription. It's a really nice thing to see that people are appreciating it and are checking back every so often, but it also helps us out with the algorithms from YouTube to distribute our videos, allowing us to get bigger and allowing us to afford the kind of stuff that we're showing you every time when we produce a video. Thanks for taking your time. Thanks for watching. Stay safe, have fun, and I'll see you soon.